Members of the research community, ladies and gentlemen and fellow colleagues, good morning, assalamu alaikum, and may peace be with you. I am David Moore, Qatar National Research Fund. I'll be your MC for this morning. And welcome to the 8th QNRF Annual Forum. Now, please join me in welcoming Dr. Abdel Sattar Altai, Executive Director of QNRF, to the podium for the opening speech.
Thank you, David. Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, members of the research community, both in Doha and those across the globe who have been joining us for the online streaming. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to QNRF 8th Annual Forum. For us, 2016 is a very special year, as it represents the 10th anniversary for the establishment of QNRF. And hence, I found that it's very fitting to choose the title QNRF 10 Years of Achievement. Also, what makes our forum this year unique is its merge or integration with the ARC 16, the Annual Research Conference 2016, which is timely also for from this perspective, as QNRF is really is funding the majority of the research papers presented in this conference. I was told we have around 400 papers that were generated from QNRF funding in this conference. Let me start by telling you the story of QNRF, and let me start by this inspiring words of His Highness Sheikh Hamad bin Khalifa Al Thani, the father Amir. And if we may have the video, please.
نحن سعداء وفخورون لأننا قد نجحنا في جعل خططنا مستديمة المدى لا ترتهن بتقلبات أسعار المواد الهيدروكربونية، وهذا ما يؤكد بأن تأسيسنا للصندوق القطري لرعاية البحث العلمي كان اختياراً ضرورياً، حيث أن وقفيته ستؤمن الموارد الضرورية لتنفيذ المشاريع.
Indeed, these are the foresight of the father Amir was since then he even was foreseeing the decline in the oil prices and how we should accommodate that, and it's really giving us the inspiration to not rely on the hydrocarbon resources per se. So, how was QNRF jump-started? Back in 2003 when Her Highness tasked the Rand Qatar Policy Institute to prepare a study about the establishment of a funding agency in Qatar to complement the previous work in the establishment of the Education City and also the QSTP. And Rand published their first report in April 2004. And then there was a very important event. A lot of you, or some of you might remember it, but a lot of you might not have heard of it. It's called Intelligentsia Qatar, IQ Qatar 2006. That was actually the founding conference of the Arab expatriate scientists. And I had the privilege to be invited then, and then also in April 2006, there was this directive from Her Highness to establish the QNRF steering committee. So the startup team arrived, And you can see I marked the three startup members who arrived then. And we all work under the leadership of Dr. Amer Al-Saadi, who was the advisor research to Her Highness at that time. So, how did we take vision to reality? We had a strategic goal, which is to establish a world-class funding agency. But what were our tactics? What we did actually, the tactics which we adopted was that we think outside the box. We don't mimic any other funding agency. We did have the advice that, look guys, this is a horrendous job. You should go and get contract with NSF, NIH, or whatever. They can help you, and then you learn, and then you can be QNRF. We didn't go for that. Very other important strategic decision which we took, that we wanted to go paperless right from the beginning, and this is an added challenge, as you all might realize. And what we had in the back of our mind was to the revival of the Arab Renaissance, because really, it's about time for the region to really take its role in technology and in knowledge production, because we've been consumers of technology for a long decades. And we had another very important sort of tactic, and that we said we should rely on our in-house, our own in-house efforts, rather than outsource the many things that we needed to establish. And guess what? In October, only in October, you know, remember that we arrived around July, and we didn't even have offices then. So we decided to approach the thing in a way that we don't want to go systematic. We recruit, we establish policies and procedures, and then have nice headquarters, and then we interject with funding agencies, and then we come with designs of programs and so on. No, we took it our way, and so we launched the Europe first cycle immediately. You know, that was a few months after we arrived in October 2006. And as you can see from this banner, we didn't even have our own logo at that time. And just to show you how things moved, you know, how we expedited things, we were ready for signing the MOU. And most of you, you know, the issues related to legalities and negotiations, that was done in this also very short time from the completion of that cycle. So it was in March 2007. Then we then immediately in April, you know, a few months later also, we launched the MPRP first cycle. That was the inaugural sort of public presentation. I acted at that time as the MPRP program manager. We didn't have Noor at that time, so I was the program manager for the MPRP. And you can see a new member joined us over there. His name is Mahmoud Talat. Actually, Mahmoud had a pivotal role in the establishment of the infrastructure that needed, and to really, he was very important for us because he accepted the spirit that we should go paperless right from the beginning. We need to do so many things in-house, and against the advice of many, we did it. But then Mahmoud joined us actually in November 2007. Then you can imagine that when we launched the first cycle, we went to March 2008, and we started signing the MOUs. You know, it might sound very, the fund management agreement. It might sound very simple, you know, what is fund management agreement? But imagine that QNRF had to negotiate all the legal. Thank you. I'd like to welcome Mr. Faisal Al-Suwaidi, President of R&D. Thank you, Mr. Faisal, for your attendance. So it was only in a short time we launched, after launching the MPRP first cycle, we started signing the fund management agreements. The fund management agreement, some of the colleagues from the education city, even Qatar University, that was a long-winded battle to agree on terms and conditions. So you can see the way we were expediting things. So now QNRF coming of age. You know that from that little seed that was planted in early 2003, then came to it was seeded in 2006. We grew up to this really beautiful, colorful tree. The three leaves represents all the fields of science that QNRF is entrusted with funding. Just to give you comparison from personal perspective, when we arrived to Doha, that was my son Hamza. He was only 8 years old, and he grew to this handsome young man, if I may say so. So, coming in age, first thing, you know, we were doing, I always remember Dr. Nabil's metaphor, you know, he said, he used to tell me that, Dr. Abdusattar, now we need to build the road, actually start manufacturing the car, we need to build the road, and then learn to drive, and we had to do all these things simultaneously, and that was the spirit of the establishment of QNRF. So we didn't wait till we had the staffing all on board. We started growing slowly but surely, and that's how it all we ended up to. Now we are around 61 staff members at QNRF. That's some photos for our previous fora. Then our, you know, when we started with the pilot projects with the Europe and then the MPRP first cycle, we started expanding in our portfolio, program funding portfolio. And we started from the capacity building, and we had the, you know, because our mandate is to fund research at all levels, from school kids to renowned scientists. So we had the Europe as a pilot project, then we added to it the CESREP and the capacity building, and then for the competitive funding, besides the MPRP, we added MPRP EP later on, and then the Junior Scientist Research Experience Program, and then we also had the sort of the research connection sort of activities like the conference workshop sponsorship program. Then 2012, QNRF really changed gear and it went into phase two. Phase two marked the QNRS, the release of QNRS 2012. So QNRF really restructured itself to align with the QNRS and our funding portfolio started growing. So now we are addressing research at the K-12 level. Then besides Europe, we added the Graduate Students Research Awards. Then we had the Postgraduate Research Awards. And then we had the Early Career Research Award that's frozen now. And then we have the other activity related to training. And with regards to the funding program, we started growing and we had some co-funding opportunities with NIH, with the USRA, with DFI, and also we started addressing some of the themes of the grant challenges. We went also to the PPM and also we established some international relationship with funding agencies and platforms like Belmont. And also with regards to the links, we grew up to many of the activities. So how did we build the ecosystem? You know, People might think to the funding agency very in a simplistic manner. What is it? You submit a proposal, you do the marking, then you announce the results like any other teacher or faculty member. In reality, it is not like that. So here you go. These are all the things which we had to really build diligently, and that really constitute the ecosystem that QNRF generated over the years. Then we went to the website. This is one of the things that, when we first came, people told us, look, website is a taboo, don't go for it. And there's where Mahmoud and his team joined in. And we managed to get the first version of our website in 2007, actually in February 2007. Then we used the PHP technology with the web content management system, and now we are using the most up-to-date technology, as most of you have seen, is the new technology. The website visibility. We drew some statistics from the visibility of QNRF. We had around 175,000 sessions last year on QNRF website. This is the other thing which correlates to the going, we wanted to go paper. IT solution, integrated IT solutions. And most of you now are aware about what's happening in our new Q grant, which it is really using the latest state of technology, and we have all the available dashboards at all level, at the applicant level, at the institution level, at our staff level, even we can make it at the national level. And as for connecting researchers, really we had, through the conference workshop program, we sponsored so many events, and really that made a great connection to the research community in Qatar. Also, we supported the Challenge 22. Really, it was a very important initiative, and we linked up with them, and they launched their first program. And also we had the ongoing link with the UK and the British Council, and we are organizing many joint activities. So what are our achievements? What have we achieved so far? So if you look at this table, it sums up for QNRF programs. We had an excess of, well, received an excess of 8,500 proposals submitted, awarded around 2,300, and the amount committed so far is in around committed, that's not actually expended, approaching to $1 billion. However, the success rate, overall success rate, is around 26%. And of course, there will be some announcements with the question marks that will be dealt with by Noor later on in her presentation. This is a quick sort of information about the distribution of the major recipients of our NPRP funding, of course, Qatar University being the national university, the biggest university, so they are receiving 41% of our funding, followed by TAMUK, Qatar receiving 24%, and Weill Cornell number 3, 11, and the great thing, to see HMC receiving around 8%, considering when we started they were only service providers. Building human capital inside Qatar, because that was really the main objective also of the QNRF in phase one. So as you can see, we had supported more than 2,600 undergraduate students, more than 1,000 graduate students, 1,100 postdoc, and around 2,100 key investigators. That's a lot, really, for Qatar. But then, in addition to these figures, we also provided the opportunity for the recruitment of the supporting staff, like lab technicians, research assistants, research associates. Creating research culture, you know, because that was also was one of our objectives. So how do we reflect that? How is this reflected? We cannot say, you know, we have created research culture. It should reflect on certain KPIs or parameters. Look at that. The announcement of the most international university in the world in 2016. That was for Qatar University. That was great achievement. And the other big achievement for Qatar University moved hundreds of places, and now it is within the 500 ranking in Shanghai ranking or QS ranking. The other very important impact, Texas A&M Qatar was selected the best MENA university last year. As I mentioned, Hamad now, if you look at Hamad's HMC's, the HMC's logo, they have the added education and they added research. This is great because now we are involving our stakeholders in doing research, and you've seen the percentage, which is really appreciable. For international partners or partnerships, we provided the opportunity for our researchers to partner with more than 590 collaborative institutions coming from 50 countries worldwide. And that's why, you know, you see in the streaming, many people are watching this presentation or this session because they are also eager to see the outcome of their collaboration. Going into the scientific output, this is one of the sort of low-hanging fruit in any research. So, but you can see that QNRF really made huge impact. You see the surge in publication, and also this is the distribution of the publications. And it's not only about quantity of publication, but rather the quality. The quality as reflected in this slide, that we have the average field-weighted citation is 85% higher than the world average. This is big achievement for Qatari researchers. And also there's another figure, but that's by Sivel analysis, really. It's not us. So we have 25% of our sponsored publication in the top 10% of the world most cited publication. So quality and quantity, I stress that. This graph also showing you how QNRF is doing with international collaboration. So we have high share of international collaboration. This is synergy, really. We are really, this is how we are building capacity in Qatar. Talking about impact, this is a study done for QNRF by RAND, and this is where QNRF is at this stage. You see, as Her Highness pointed out in her plenary or in her opening speech, it's a slow process. It's not happening tomorrow that we have we will go into knowledge-based economy. It takes a long time. However, already we are having the direct economic multiplier effect. We are having the scientific output, as I have indicated. And then in the long run, I think even you can align this to the 2030 vision of Qatar 20 vision, and we hope that we will be moving into that zone when we rely on our resources. The reason I showed you that S-curve curve or a slide to show you that invention disclosure and IP is a slow process. It takes long time, much longer time. But I can assure you it is there in the pipeline. It will be coming in due time. And this is the reported figure from our IPTT colleagues. What really for QNRF, we stick to our very important values. And these are, you know, these values really, I think we cherished and we protected in such a way that really made the QNRF in its position now, as it stands now, with transparency. Most of you know QNRF. We are transparent. We don't give any favoritism. We comply by conflict of interest, non-disclosure, IRBs, etc. We also believe in equal opportunity. If we give an opportunity to somebody, to a researcher or institution, we will give it to everybody else, and that's very important. Learn to improve. All of you, one of the real important tools that we use to improve QNRF performance and is we always listen to you. We are good listeners, and we pick the lessons learned and we incorporate them in our program. I hope for the last one, we are committed to excellence, and I appreciate, I think you would tend to agree with me in this regard. So the way forward for QNRF. So heading to a new phase, QNRF will focus on optimizing resources. And you know that really this is a very important exercise for all of us. We will be funding research of comparative advantage to Qatar. We will be encouraging innovative research. As you've seen, there are the two very important chains. We have the research and innovation, and we need to link up because this is how we move into generating spin-out companies and moving to a knowledge-based economy. Then we are enhancing the industry involvement in research. This is a big, it's been a big challenge and remained a big challenge. And I hope that with the support of our leadership, we will get the industry or the industrial stakeholders on board. We will be promoting joint funding program initiatives. But most importantly, that we will be moving from the predominantly investigator-driven research to increasingly mission-driven research. This is very important because this is phase, I call it even phase three. We need to really focus on the specific requirements of Qatar to the hotspot technology, to the niche areas that related to Qatar needs. If you allow me, I will give you this little nostalgic journey with time, and you will see some glimpse of QNRF history. And to some of us, really, it's not coming of age, it's going of age. But allow me to start with this, please. And so now it only remains for me to thank everyone who has been involved in the success of QNRF. First and outmost, I would like to extend a deep appreciation and a special thanks to Her Highness Sheikh Hamouza bin Nasser, Chairperson of Qatar Foundation, for her enduring vision in creating QNRF. Next, Mr. Faisal Al-Suwaidi for his leadership, his continued guidance, and putting together the roadmap for the research in Qatar. Dr. Hamad Al-Ibrahim for his trust and unwavering support of QNRF. And last but not least, I would like to say a special thank you to each and every one of the hard-working QNRF staff, without whom we would not be where we are today. Thank you all, and God bless.